in the early 1920s, in addition to trying to iron out these disagreements with Einstein, Whitehead develops a new philosophy of nature, where he's critical of what he calls the bifurcation of nature. And going back to Galileo, and this is a point that Philip Goff has made in some of his work as well, there was this methodological split between primary characteristics, you know, all the stuff that can be measured objectively, you know, mass and dimensionality and whatnot, and then secondary characteristics, which would be all of the subjective qualities that for Galileo would just be added by the perceptual organs of living beings. And for science's purposes, that secondary stuff can be left out. Science is interested in the primary characteristics. Whitehead thinks that methodologically that worked well enough. It allowed science to advance, but it leaves us in a rather odd situation where we have these two different domains, what he called the conjecture, which is the way that science models the primary characteristics, and the dream, which is how we actually experience the world in terms of colors and scents and qualities. And Whitehead wanted to bring these two back together and say, look, science is the study of nature. What is nature? Nature is everything that we are aware of in perception. And that includes the redness of the sunset as much as the electromagnetic waves by which the physicist might want to understand that radiation. Redness is not just a subjective projection onto nature. It is part of nature. It's not that the redness is say, you know, in the sun or in the rose. It's a relational quality, but nonetheless, nature is made of relationships. And when we're doing science, we're studying the patterns that inhere in our perceptual experience.
Okay.
Right. And he doesn't want us to say, start trying to pick and choose what's in the mind and what's in nature. Just science is the study of the perceptual field and the relational patterns that allow us to, you know, yeah, build models and make predictions about what we might expect to perceive next. And so in this early phase of his philosophical work, he's doing philosophy of science, and he's saying, look, if science is the study of nature and nature is what we are aware of in perception, that means that mind or consciousness is not something that science can actually study. Science presupposes mind and consciousness.
So let me see if I follow that. Nature is awareness plus perception?
What we are aware of in perception.
So nature is what appears to us in perception. And embedded in perception is then a perceiver. And so if science is the study of nature, then we are assuming a perceiver. We're assuming a subject already. And the subject has embedded in that mind.
Right.
So we're assuming mind. Okay, I get it.
Right. Right. Science presupposes that there is a knowing mind. And this is a point that, you know, Kant makes as well. This is kind of what this term transcendental means. It's not the same as transcendent. Kant would say that natural science has certain transcendental conditions of possibility. And Whitehead agrees with that. What that means is that there are certain things that natural science has to assume, but can't prove in its own terms. For example, the unity of nature. Kant would say that the unity of nature is a transcendental idea that guides scientific research. The very notion of a law presupposes that the phenomena of nature are ordered in a systematic way, right, such that we can discover these universal principles, these laws that apply everywhere. Now,
that one I'm not quite sure about, because let's say there is disunity in nature, then it just could be that it's in another universe that's causally disconnected from us and it follows different laws or doesn't follow any law. So the unity of nature seems to me to be the unity of our perceptions of nature or the observable universe or something like that. Not necessarily that nature itself is unified, outside of what we
well, remember perceive. Kant's only talking about the phenomenal world, not the world of things in themselves. And so,
okay. The unity of the phenomenal.
Yeah. Maybe there are, there, it could be that there's a dis, it could be that there's a disunity of nature, but if we're going to have science, we have to presuppose unity, or there's no sense to be made of a law.
Okay.
Right. And so Kant's limiting natural scientific knowledge to the phenomenal world, to the way that nature appears to our mind. And for our mind to make sense of nature as a system with laws, it needs to be unified. It needs to be one system. That's not to say that beyond the phenomenal realm, there might not be other universes. It's just we can't say anything scientific about that, you would say. Science for Kant means it's systematic, necessary, universal knowledge. And I think this is where, you know, contemporary physicists like to talk all the time about other universes and the multiverse and many worlds and so on. And from Kant's point of view, they're doing metaphysics and like bad, bad metaphysics, because all of that's way beyond anything we can experience or become aware of in perception, right? And so philosophically, Kant would say all of this talk, like theoretical physics has become, has just gone off the rails, he would say. He would be, I think, pretty good buddies with Sabine Hossenfelder in that critique of where theoretical physics has gone, that it's become metaphysics in an ungrounded sense.
I see. Like how Kant was critiquing other metaphysicians for speaking about what's unknowable. We have no way to decide it. And then he's saying, well, let's start with what's knowable. And by the way, I'm saying knowable, not noble.
Yeah.
That's a similar critique that could be laid at much of the abstractions in theoretical physics today.
Right. Mm-hmm. So Whitehead's agreeing with Kant that science has certain transcendental conditions, that there are minds capable of knowing, transcendental condition of science, that nature is intelligible. And so in this early philosophy of science work, Whitehead's trying to dissolve this bifurcation of nature so that we don't imagine that science is just trying to describe to us a world of mechanical matter in motion, devoid of any quality, devoid of color and scent and texture and all the stuff that makes our life meaningful and valuable. But at this point, he's not bringing mind into the picture. He's not trying to do metaphysics and talk about the place of mind in nature. He's just saying natural science presupposes that there is mind, at least in the scientists, you know, doing the science. And, you know, later he'll say, one of my favorite lines is he says that scientists animated by the purpose of proving that they are purposeless constitute an interesting subject of study, right? And so conscious agency for Whitehead is just it's a hardcore common sense presupposition. And without it, we couldn't have science. And so for a scientist to start claiming like, oh, we're just lumbering robots allowing our genes to make copies of themselves, or that we're fully deterministic, consciousness is an illusion, like all of that sort of talk undermines the possibility of science from this point of view. It's like pulling the rug out from under your feet. But Whitehead doesn't really try to elaborate on the place of mind in the physical world until later. He's invited to Harvard in 1924 and starts teaching philosophy for the first time. Before that, he had taught math, he had taught astronomy. Harvard invites him to teach philosophy, and he'd been wanting an opportunity to work out some of his metaphysical ideas. And so in his first semester at Harvard, he ends up giving a series of lectures that became Science in the Modern World, his 1925 book, where he both gives a history of science and mathematics and begins to elaborate what he calls his organic realism. And so just like Schelling drew on and expanded upon what Kant had articulated in the Critique of Judgment about the nature of self-organization, Whitehead begins to develop this idea of organism or self-organization as the basis for a new cosmology, and wants to understand these scientific objects like atoms as self-organizing systems, which are in effect tiny organisms. And just as organisms at the biological scale seem to have some degree of agency and interiority, he would say, you know, every self-organizing system in nature, all the way down the scale, has some degree of minimal agency and interiority or experience. Now, the experience of an atom and the agency of an atom is so minimal that we can devise mathematical laws to predict the behavior of those atoms with, you know, very high precision. There's very little in the way of free choice at that scale. Nonetheless, it seems, you know, at least on some interpretations of quantum theory, there's not complete determinism. There is moment by moment an integration of what's already been actualized in the past with what remains possible in the future. And so part of what Whitehead's already doing in science of the modern world is, you know, quantum physics hadn't been fully worked out yet, but he's aware that there are certain features of Newtonian mechanics that no longer are true. For example, simple location, the idea that a bit of matter can be, its location can be understood independent of all other bits of matter. Like, there's no more absolute space. And similarly, there seems to be some kind of non-local entanglement. So he's trying to understand the physical world without presupposing simple location and without presupposing that there could be any meaning given to the idea of nature at an instant. It would seem that it takes a certain duration for even a photon to fully manifest as a photon. And so the idea that nature could be reconstructed out of freeze frames, instantaneous slices, for Whitehead no longer makes any sense. And so this is why he starts to think in terms of process, in terms of events. And rather than thinking in terms of substances, where you remember a substance is defined as that which requires nothing but itself in order to exist, for Whitehead, there is no such thing in the world. Everything is bound up in a nexus of relations, and relationality becomes ultimate. There are entities which come into relationship, but every entity, actual entity in his terms, is itself a nexus of relations. And all relations for Whitehead are experiential, which is to say, instead of thinking of cause and effect as just a mechanical process, it's really something more like cause and affect, if you will.
Yeah.
It feels like causal transmission feels like something. And so moment by moment, these actual entities, whether we're talking about events occurring at the atomic scale or events occurring at the level of our psychological experience, we are feeling conformally with the past, and we are feeling a kind of field of possibilities available to us in the next moment, and integrating the feeling of the past with the feeling of possibility, and some decision is being made as to what we are going to become next. Right. And so at the smallest, simplest scale, that's a largely deterministic process, almost deterministic, but not fully. There's always some degree of possibility. And at the human scale, you know, we have almost infinite imaginative freedom. I mean, we can't sprout wings and fly in the next moment, but at least at the level of our stream of consciousness, we can imagine almost anything. And our consciousness can become quite untethered from our past environment. Even if, in terms of our bodies and how we engage the world metabolically and physiologically, we're bound to conformal relationships to our past. We still have a very high degree of freedom to, in Whitehead's terms, ingress alternatives moment by moment. And so his metaphysics, his understanding of the way that mind and nature can be integrated has a lot to do with how quantum physics brings potentiality back into the picture. Whereas in Newtonian mechanics, we could imagine nature as just the sum total of already actualized particles, you know, colliding in absolute space. Contemporary physics has forced us to make room for potentiality. And there's a lot of confusion about how potentiality and actuality relate, which leads to like the many worlds interpretation where, you know, every possible pathway in the wave function, say, is actualized in some other universe, because there's a refusal in that case, I would say, in the case of many worlds, to acknowledge this distinction between actuality and potentiality and just say, no, it's all, every one of them is actualized. And Whitehead say, no, there's a difference. There's an ontological difference between the actual and the potential. And we need to find a way of thinking that allows us to hold the two in tension. And that mind, one way of understanding what mind is, and I'm just in the most general sense, mind, consciousness, experience, is this process of integration of the actual with the possible and the decision that is made about which possibility to actualize moment by moment by moment.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.